On this episode of Land of Tamarack Homestead, animals with a purpose, planting plum trees, Hugel style, wild crafting pine needles, the teepee rain catcher, and more.
You hearing this, Paul?
Yep. Sounds like that dadgum Hollywood narrator.
What do you think, Paul?
There he is. Get him! I told you they was buzzards.
I'm not awake yet. I'm assuming we need, you know, dishes done.
Yep.
I know my teepee's trashed, but if, you know.
Grandma needs to do the teepee. Well, me and the girls can do the dishes.
Well, we can, we also got to get some laundry done since we're going to have a nice day, too. So.
I'll do laundry. Okay. We don't really do this in the morning.
Wild Bill and Ray are going to get water this morning. These are our miniature Hugel culture style raised beds. But today, we're going to show you how to plant plum trees, Hugel style.
What we're doing here is we're digging a hole. We're transplanting some trees that we were given last, probably summer or fall. And they've been in pots growing in the greenhouse. Now they're ready to transplant outside, and they're plum trees.
The boys are so kind, they dug us a big hole. How far down do you think you went with the center?
Well, the outer perimeter, we went down about 2 feet, and then we did a hole in the center that went down to gravel. The idea is that since we have clay in this area, the trees will die after a couple years of sitting in the clay, from what I've learned. And so we dug a hole down to gravel and sand so that the hole will drain and the trees will survive.
So it's probably, it looked like it was about 2.5 to 3 feet down below what you can see here. Because this right about there is the bottom of the round one. And we filled that one up with fresh cut wood instead of rotten wood, so it'll take longer to decompose down the road, and it'll feed the tree and provide moisture for the tree during the hot time of the year. It'll soak up all the moisture in the wet time and then provide it in the summer. And then for this layer, we're doing rotten wood, broken down wood, twigs that are less than an inch in diameter. Some are bigger, but the ones that are less than an inch in diameter have the most nutritional benefits for the plants and the trees as far as decomposing and feeding them. We're gonna throw a couple extra layers of rabbit poo and bedding and comfrey leaves in this hole as well.
We've got the base filled with our wood here, our little branches and twigs and stuff, and next layer we're gonna add is bark mulch. Pushing it in there. There you go.
The next layer we'll be throwing in is comfrey. We went around the yard and chopped it down. Throw it right in. Get in and just kind of try to spread it around evenly. Yep, and then go ahead, Starlight, stomp down. Layer of rabbit poo and bedding, leftovers in the hole.
Oh, yeah. I think I'm kinked.
You're kinked?
It happens in old age.
We'll probably soak this hole for like 5 minutes, get it really good and wet, and then we'll plant our tree.
Are you taking it?
Yeah. Oh. You take the pot.
Oh, Oh, it shouldn't have been there in the first place, huh?
And that's how we plant plum trees, hugel culture style.
Hey, that's how I kill my crow. It's called a trick shot. See how my fingers don't even the trigger? I use my shoulder hairs to pull the trigger. It takes time and ingenuity, but I can do it. And some people wonder why I'm still single, right?
Originally, when we moved out here, our intention was to hook up to the grid. There was a house that burned down about 2 years before we got here.
Well, our intention was to kind of reestablish a camp or a living space here, because it was, you couldn't live here.
Yeah.
But it was also to practice a sustainable living, gardening, and community, which is a growth process. And so this has all been a massive learning opportunity that we all had in our hearts to do, to learn how to do the old style, growing your food, cooking it over wood, living off grid. Yes, we were initially gonna go on grid, but we discovered that we don't need to. You can do really well and prosper and feel really good about what you're doing while you're off grid.
This is our water tower. It's made from an old junk hot tub that was just lying around the property. We raised it up on posts near the area outside the garden at the highest point so that we can gravity feed it down to the garden to the common area with nothing but a simple garden hose. And we fill the water tower with this hose attached to a gas-powered water pump.
Well, we're using the water pump to fill up this water tower here in the summer, but in the winter it's a completely different story.
In the winter we can't use the water pump because it will freeze. And so we haul up 5 gallon buckets full of water by hand.
So the water we get from the creek that goes into the water tower, it goes to watering our animals, washing our dishes, clothes, showers, any non-potable purposes. The water that we drink, we have to transport from a natural spring not too far away.
The pump works great. It only takes a few minutes to fill the tower.
Healthier, it's simpler, less expensive, it's more satisfying.
Well, being off grid means different things to different people. There's different different levels of being off grid, and for us, when we say off grid, it's not that we don't have any electricity at all. At first, we plugged our cell phones into our car and ran our car, but that got real expensive. And so the next summer, we bought a generator, and we use a generator once a day to charge a fridge up and get a cold and to charge our cell phones.
Living out here, doing everything without electricity or, all the benefits of modern society, we were working harder. We were, we became healthy. We all lost like 50 pounds easy within like the first 6-8 months.
Wildcrafting with Huckleberry. She ain't no daisy picker.
beyond the Columbia, deep in the wilderness, high in the mountains, above the snow line, grows the richest and most aromatic pine needles.
Actually, you don't have to go very far to find pine needles. You may have some in your own backyard. Many early American pioneers survived their first few winters on pine needle tea. It is a sure cure for scurvy. Pine needle tea has 4 to 5 times more vitamin C than a lemon. It is an immune system booster, good for healthy vision, skin, and hair. Historically, many remedies were made by the pioneers to cure colds, flu, bladder and kidney issues, depression, dementia, and tumors, among many other things. After letting your pine needles steep for 15 minutes in hot water, it's ready. Grandpa noticed that wild rabbits eat the pine needles off the branches in the snowy winter months, so we harvest them and give them to our rabbits as a treat. They love them.
Alright, so reasons I moved out here. I was tricked and coerced into... No,
You be honest!
I am being honest.
I'm leaving.
I was slightly tricked and coerced. And no.
I'll go back to the garden.
No, I wasn't tricked. I wasn't coerced. But I went from making 60,000-ish a year, you know, some years 70,000, but we couldn't get anywhere. We just got sick and tired of the BS, and it, you know, let's go to the polar extreme. This isn't working. This isn't making us happy. You know, we were happy together, but ultimately there's so many other negative forces in our life, and it's, hey, we need to try something different. Why not try this? What's the worst that happens? We go back to what we had before, and, you know, buy off-grid. We have a generator. You know, we're not fronting. We have a camera that needs charge. We have, you know, our cell phones to keep in contact with people because we don't have a landline. So we have to, you know, we have to be smart. If somebody gets hurt or something, we need to be able to call 911. You know, we're not out here risking our lives, but, you know, people live in way worse situations across the globe and are happy somehow. And we're blessed with the abundance of what we have, really, and the situation. And no matter what little discomforts we have, this is a true chance for us all to thrive and survive and be happy and figure ourselves out and just not buy into the BS.
Well, we're moving our 18-foot in diameter teepee to a new location.
And the hornets.
There's one more.
Oh, there you go.
I just haven't been stung in a really, really, really long time.
Trying to kill a wasp this big with a pole this big. Yeah. Part of the thing.
we're not hardcore off-gridders. I mean, we may someday decide, yeah, we want to go back on the electrical grid because it is more convenient. The benefit of not having is it forces us to seek an alternative way to live. You know, people lose electricity in the neighborhood and we never know it. We're okay without it.
When we first moved here, we had one rooster and seven hens and some cats.
Animals with a purpose.
So we finished our barn last year and we're able to add more livestock this year. And we added more chickens, we added a couple more ducks and rabbits.
Wow.
This is Philbert. He was our first bunny. This is Jubilee. So all the animals that we have on our homestead must serve a purpose, at least one. We carefully research each animal and find out which ones are going to best suit our needs and purposes. So we chose the black Australorp chickens here because they're a docile breed and they also can lay 300 plus eggs a year, which is, you know, fabulous. We also chose the Buff Orpingtons because they're, again, a very docile breed and they can lay up to 260 eggs a year, but they're also excellent brooders. So they are our newest addition to our livestock this year. The chickens are not just great egg producers, but they're also raised for meat purposes as well. And that both the black Australorps and the buff Orpingtons are a medium to large sized chicken. And so they meet that purpose really well. Another purpose for having chickens is the manure factor, which is a great fertilizer for your garden after you let it sit and rest. They're also great at when they free range, they eat a lot of the insects, especially ticks.
We have the khaki camel ducks because they are good egg layers and they are very tasty for meat ducks.
The reason that we have cats is for catching mice, moles, and gophers.
We have our dog Bodhi so he can protect us from the predators.
And he can chase the cows away
and play with us every day.
The dog is also great for warning us of predators, protecting the children, and just as well as just fun.
Get the stick.
We chose the Satin Angora rabbits so that we could use their wool and ice spin, and so we make a lot of hats and our own gloves, socks, mittens, scarves, all of that. And the Satin Angora, or the Angora wool, is actually 7 times warmer than sheep's wool, so we blend it. We do a blend of Angora with the wool just to make things that much warmer. We also have added meat rabbits this year, and we have a mix of Californian New Zealand and a New Zealand satin.
Well,
I think
he's
scared.
No.
Not only do rabbits provide the wool and meat and stuff, but they also provide their manure for the garden, which is awesome. And you can just take it right out of the pen and put it right into your garden.
Why?
No,
kind of
like body language, you know? It's
why?
Just like, you know,
I think it's really important that even though our animals are all multi-purpose and some of them are used or raised to be consumed, it's still really important to love all your animals and give them the best life possible that benefits them and you ultimately in the end.
You want to tell us what you're doing here, Pa?
Well, what I'm doing here is I'm building a door for the barn.
And when I get done with this door, we're gonna hang it. This is the door. That's the mechanism for opening and closing it. Okay, got the plastic on, the door frame's built, we gotta put the hinges on and some boards on the front, and we're ready to hang it. Woo! And there, okay. Test her out. Next, we're going to show you a little invention I made to help keep the rain out of your teepee. I call it the Rain Catcher 3000. The Rain Catcher 3000, it slices, it dices, it collects rainwater and sheds it out of your teepee. Once installed inside the top of your teepee, it goes to work in all weather conditions, rain, sleet, and snow. The Rain Catcher 3000 will change your life. Just listen to the satisfied customer.
I installed the Rain Catcher 3000 in my teepee. Now I am rich.
You'll want to purchase the Rain Catcher 3000, but you can't because it's not available in stores. You will have to make it yourself. Warning, do not use wax canvas unless you want your teepee to become a flaming fireball. Side effects may include a drier environment and cause hysterical laughter with continued use.
This is the rain catcher I made for the 18-foot teepee. It's made out of a very cheap cotton drop cloth for painters. And I took it and folded over the edges and painted it with latex water-based house paint. Exterior preferable. Then I also added grommets. We added rope to tie it off. And then we hang it up under the vent, smoke vent hole. When you go to make your rain catcher, you're gonna have to take your own measurements of your particular teepee. Each teepee is gonna be a little bit different. It's gonna be wider at the top. It's gonna narrow down to the width of between the poles at the top of the liner. And then it's gonna go down slowly to get wider again to just be long enough to go on the outside of your door. Okay, the rain catcher, when you install it, you want to install it so it's stretched loose. It'll create a channel so that when the rain falls down on the rain catcher, the rain will run down and to the outside of the door. But when you install it, you want to make sure there's enough airflow room so that the smoke rises, goes around the rain catcher, up and through the flaps. The rain catcher will help provide a drier environment in your teepee by catching about 90% of the rainfall that comes in. Next time, we'll show you modifications we made to keep our teepee warmer.
It shows.
Homemade bread, special with honey on it.
Perfect.
Get out of here!
what we're doing here is making a bed. That's Bean's bed and this is my bed. So this bed's taller, that bed's shorter.
Are you calling me short?
No.
Well, we need a bed so we can sleep in it.
No, they just decided a couple days ago that they wanted their own beds.
The plan, what is the plan for today? The plan is to make it to tomorrow. And then tomorrow will be today. And then we'll deal with today. So you just deal with today. That's the plan. It's my plan.
You know, I've been a lot of places in my life. This is definitely one of them.
Tell Tiny Tim I won't make it home this Christmas.
We will show you what we have learned so far without living with
and what life is like on
a daffodil in Florida.
Nearly basis.
It's the directors. And you're filming it, aren't
you? Yeah.
What was that you just said about what?
It's the directors that's the problem, not the actors.
Uh-huh. All right.
We will show you what we have learned living off the... Damn it. Okay.
All right, everyone.
We will show you what we have learned so far about living without the electric grid. We will show you.
It's a hard line. It's written...
We will show you what we have learned so far about living without the electric. We will show you what we have learned so far about living without the electric.
We will show you what we have learned so far about living without
the electric.
Harvesting and preserving food.
We will show you what we have learned without living with technological witchcraft.
I don't want your coffee in there. My coffee's fine. Are you recording yet?
Yeah.
Oh, great.
Harvesting and preserving food. Tamarack!